All right, today I'm working on a Blue 101. This is one of the earlier models without the auto stop, in blue color. Original machine right down to the original handle on there. Usually you find those all cracked and split, but not in this case. I did have to replace the spring. It was weak, really weak. So, had to go, and I had a new spring in stock, so I used it. It was the last one. But that takes care of that problem. This machine simply would not function without it. We had to substitute an all brass HMV number 4 reproducer for the pot metal one that was on this machine that literally, it just fell apart. Just completely fell apart. So, unsalvageable. But we had all brass. I put it on there. It's all rebuilt. And I'm going to spin a few records. But first, there was one problem this machine had that had me stumped a little bit. I tested the motor. That was fine. Spins nice, all that. I rebuilt the reproducer, put it on there. And when I went to play a record, it sounded terrible. I mean, really low volume. And, oh, did I put a low-tone needle on there? Nope. Loud tone. Okay. And at first I thought, okay, maybe a piece of packaging fell down into the horn. Maybe that's it. Stuck my hand in there. Nope. Didn't feel anything in there. And this went on for a while. I'm scratching my head. Like, why is this thing so low volume? So I took it all apart again. Pulled the horn completely out. I figured it's always possible that Mr. Mouse might have crawled up into them, way up into the narrowest part of the horn and expired. And his desiccated corpse is blocking it. You know, 60, 70 years ago. But that wasn't what I found. After some digging around in there, and I had to dig. Sticking my hand in the horn didn't do it. I had to get a long pair of skinny needle nose pliers, get up in there and probe around, and I punched into something soft, because first I tried to put a wire through it, and it wouldn't go. It stopped right about this part of the horn. So I knew there was something in there. So with the needle nose pliers, eventually I was able to pull out this little cloth. I'm guessing it's some kind of a pillowcase. And when it unrolls, it was really jammed in there tight. Yeah, I did not have an easy time getting this out. We have a pillowcase of some kind. And what really got me when I noticed it, I didn't notice it right away, but I looked inside, of course. My first thought was, ooh, maybe there's a big wad of cash in there. Oh, wouldn't that be good? But Peter Horn, MP39. Peter Horn. I don't know if that's a brand name or if that is, it looks like it's hand-stitched in there. Somebody's name? Little name tag for some reason? Peter Horn stuffed his bag in the horn. Peter Horn. Just a bag. A little dirty, but really in good shape considering it's probably been in there, I don't know, 75, 80 years. And that was the problem. Pulled it out, immediately volume restored. Now, stick a sock in it is an old expression, and it goes back to the earliest days of the Victor, you know, talking machines and Edisons and all that. They had no sound control. There was no, like, this 9 has doors here to control the sound. You didn't have that on these machines. You don't have it on this one. Well, so the only means you had of regulating the sound was literally stuff a cloth of some kind down into the horn to muffle it. Or a sock, if you chose, if that's what you had. You can use a sock. I have found similar things before, which is why I knew to look for this. You know, there was a Sirola once, had a handkerchief stuffed down into its horn. There was, or actually into its tone arm, in that case. And a few other machines with various articles, either dropped in or stuffed in. This was definitely deliberate. Definitely. This was really jammed in there hard. It didn't just fall in there and get wedged in the back. Somebody really punched in there. So I'm wondering if maybe someone in a household sometime in the past, Peter Horns perhaps, was playing the record player a little too much, a little too loud, disturbing other people's peace. So someone decided to fix that problem by sticking this into it. And I wonder if the owner of the machine ever figured it out, or if they just put it on the shelf, wrote it off as a bad reproducer, and we'll get to it one day. One day never came, and the machine sat around until I bought it. We'll never know. But that was the mystery of the volume issue, which is now solved. I'm just playing records on here, a few worn ones here to see, to test that motor, make sure the spring is good. This is Paul Whitman, Kahlua, Blue Danube, Blues, Foxtrot. Or whatever the hell they call it now. Let's see. Little chip in there. Go. And now I'm going to spin it over there and play the other side to see if the spring will power through too. Usually new springs will, but not always. It depends on how much wears on the record. Because a worn record will slow up the motor somewhat. It'll rob spring power. It takes more juice to push, like driving a car uphill. And it takes a little more juice to get it going and keep it going. So let's see. This record's not horribly worn. It has a little bit of surface wear, but that's enough to test it. Did I spin that? Yeah, and Everybody's Step is what this one is.
Thank you.
I did it! And that's a particularly long playing record, too. It tells us by looking at it. Now, what I'm going to do is try to play a later record on here. I think I might have played this one before, but this is how you use the record tray. Look at that. Perfect. They eliminated that for the 102, but they went to a tray that mounted on the turntable, and then they eliminated that also, and I guess you were just plain screwed. Let's try the slumber song. Glenn Miller, later period, but you can see the wear on that record. Now, first, however, there's a couple things we got to do, and that is going to be wind up the machine. This will take about 50 wind. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. At least it's easy to wind. You don't have to really put a lot of effort into it, and it's easy to tell when you reach the end because, oh, there we go. You feel a little bit of resistance, and it's all done. Never try to force a spring past when you feel resistance, because if you do that, you will break it. And that can get expensive. Okay. Let's see the slumber song. Slumber song's not too long. But there's a lot of wear on this, and it might slow it up. The Slumber Song, well named as Buster will slumber right through it. Okay. Oh, that's a long one. Okay, well, that's Moonlight Sonata. Let's see if it'll power through that. Let's see, because I know that the spring that was on here definitely would not have. That's for sure. It was pretty bad. That's often the case. These are not very big springs in these machines. They're portable motors. That motor was purpose-built to be for a portable machine. And they didn't want to put a big, heavy spring in there. They put one that was good enough, but only if it's in good shape. Let's see. And it did it! Look at that, and it's still going too. It did it. I'll let that spring wind down. Sorry about that rumbling in the background. It seems like a large group of motorcycle riders have decided to go to the deli across the street. And you would think we are not in the middle of a major pandemic, as we are now. But I'll let you have a look at the number of people in that parking lot over there. Sorry about the dirty window. Yeah, this is social distancing right there. And this is why our numbers in New York are climbing so high. Right there. Nice. Well, that's it for now.